Welcome everybody to this Conspiracy and Democracy Project public lecture. Today we're delighted to welcome Federico Finchelstein, who is a professor at the New School in New York. He's a professor of history and has written 5 books to date, the latest of which was The Ideological Origins of the Dirty War, which is a history of Argentina in the 20th century. And his new book that's soon to come out later this year is From Fascism to Populism in History. So we're delighted to hear from him today. Following the talk, there'll be a brief response, and then we'll open up to questions and answers, followed by a reception afterwards. So thank you, Federico.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tanya. Well, thank you very much, Tanya and Professor Evans, for inviting me here. It's such a pleasure to be here. I would like to start with two different ways, two anecdotes in which I feel that the topic of the current talk, I mean certainly is part of my life in many, many ways. And since this is a talk on history and memory, I will explain to some extent how I am in many ways both a kind of a source, I guess, but also an historian of this process, the process in which memories and histories of the dirty war are often combined and many times conflated, and I will explain why I think this is a problem. But I also thought that, I mean, when I finished this book, I thought a sense of, I was very happy, as everybody else is when he or she finishes a book, but I thought, you know, I was leaving this topic behind, and obviously I was wrong. After finishing this book, I engaged in a new project on the history of fascism and populism, on the relationships between these two political phenomena and concepts. And now that project is finished. And of course, with that project, I don't feel I have left it behind, sadly. The topic is right out there. But in a way, these topics are combined, and certainly are combined in terms of my own perception and experience. Now, when I arrived here yesterday, well, rather not here, but at Heathrow, the gentleman at immigration asked me, and he was probably a person around his mid-60s, he asked me why I was here. I said, well, I was invited to give a lecture at Cambridge. He asked me about the topic. I said, the Dirty War in Argentina. And he said, well, that was many, many years ago, and it was a very different time. And now our countries are very good friends, so I'm very happy that you are here. So, and again, I mean, to me, that was super interesting in many ways, because, I was not among the people that was questioned at the airport. I saw many people being questioned at the airport, and actually I received a congratulatory note on the topic of research, which in a way, it's exactly the opposite of what I'm trying to say. Because I don't feel, and even his comment made me feel that we have not left this history behind. As I thought, perhaps that I was doing that when I finished this book. Now, the other thing is that, Tanya asked me a version of this paper, and that made me work a lot because this was always in my mind, but not necessarily on paper. And having finally finished that version, which is not very much accomplished nor finished, but after I sent you that version, I was basically reading my Twitter account on the New York subway, and I saw that General Milani, I will explain who this guy is, was arrested. And there was a sense of me, an urge, to write an op-ed about it right away. Why? Because I have been writing exactly on the topic. And this is probably, and thanks to Tanya, my record. I wrote this in a few hours. I sent it to Clarín, the Argentine newspaper, and it was published on Sunday, in which basically that was an op-ed translation of my talk here. So if you read Spanish and you don't want to listen to me, that will be a very good way out of here. But on the other hand, I hope I can say more and give more details in the talk rather than in that short op-ed. Now, the topic that I'm dealing with is new work, in the sense that when I finish my book, I mean, the book on the Dirty War was a kind of exploration of the idea of fascism in Argentina from the period of classic fascism in the 1920s and 30s to the periods in which fascism no longer was, or in the sense that it had to be reformulated, and it was reformulated both by the Argentine right as well as by a movement of a different sort, which was Peronism. That I will be happy to talk about in the Q&A, but I will kind of leave it behind because I see that first example of populism as a reformulation of fascism that was characterized by its anti-dictatorial dimension. So I don't see Peronism as a kind of part of the path to the dirty war. Rather, it was a different route which was adopted by many on the right. And anyway, I will return to this topic a little bit later. Now, if that chapter on Peronism was a detour in my book, then after Peronism in 1955, the Argentine right returned to its old ways, which is to say fascism. Now, after 1945, and certainly in Argentina after Peronism in 55, it was very difficult to be a fascist, and they engaged in this kind of combination between fascism and perhaps a more proper neo-fascist stance. In any case, my book finished with the Dirty War as the moment in which these ideas about the enemy, these ideas about what kind of fascism Argentina deserved, I mean, as seen by the Argentine fascists, and what kind of fate the enemies of that idea deserve, again, as seen by the fascists and suffered by their enemies, is in the Dirty War in which finally that idea was translated into practice, into a massive practice of extermination. So, as opposed to many readers of that book, particularly in the Argentine press, I do not maintain that the Argentine dictatorship was a fascist dictatorship. But there is a tricky element in what I maintain, which is to say that within its concentration camps, it was the fascist ideology as it was developed in Argentina that was the main justification for the practices of torture and killing. So I'm not saying it was fascist, but I'm saying fascism had played a big role, particularly in terms of its practices of torture and extermination. Now, the book finished then, mostly I would say in 1983, which is when the dictatorship finished. And here I thought, okay, I would like to see what happened to how the Argentine perpetrators and the Argentine right see things after 83, which is to say at the time of democracy in Argentina, a democracy that Argentina had had since then. So many, many years of democracy in Argentina. A kind of Argentine record of sorts. And yet, many of my compatriots, as well as many of my colleagues, prefer to call the period after the dictatorship, which is to say, from 1983 to the present, as the post-dictatorship period. It used to be called the transition to democracy, but more recently, this is the term of sorts. We are living a post-dictatorship situation, which is very telling and symptomatic in many ways. The first, clearly, is that it seems that that past really belongs to our present. Even our present, our own democratic times, are defined by the past. And now, if you are interested in Argentine politics, you see this all the time. But what is interesting about this case, I think, is that, there are many interesting things, particularly if you are into Argentine history. If you are not, then another interesting aspect is what happens to the politics of memory as perceived not only by the victims or those who might claim a status of bystanders, either they were or not bystanders, but also to the perpetrators. And this is my emphasis, this is my stress, which is I want to study what goes on with the politics of memory as experienced and devised by perpetrators. And I kind of did that in my book for the dictatorship period, how they were experiencing the events in which they were primary actors as killers, and they saw that as a kind of historical moment, a turning point in Argentine history. So in a way, the politics of memory by the Argentine perpetrators started during the dictatorship. And I will return to this topic in a second. So, but this is a stress. So now, first, I mean, I'm pretty sure that many of you know about the state of the question in terms of the historiography or the approaches by historians on the question of history and memory. I would like just to gloss over this just briefly to give you an idea of where we stand. And of course, you might object to this as big as a topic that it is in the Q&A. But for the sake of argument, I would like to say that here, that in the present, I mean, and in the case that actually affected the Argentine case the most, as many other politics of memories in which there are experiences of mass violence and even genocide in some cases, the paradigm of these politics of memory is the Holocaust. And it is the Holocaust that has challenged historians, but also has shaped the ways in which historians that are not working on the Holocaust conceive of these paradigms. So if more generally in the beginning, and I might say this, but in fact I'm referring to probably the 1980s, if not a little bit before or a little bit afterwards. But in the beginning, so to speak, when these questions of history and memory started to be, reconsidered again by historians, the emphasis was on the opposition between history and memory. The most famous case, of course, is that of Pierre Nora. But there are many other cases. Now, why they will conceive of history and memory as being opposed? Well, I think the answer is obvious, because they are opposed. There is history and there is memory, and these are very different things. Now, the same kind of paradigm was adopted by important people working on the field of Holocaust historiography or Holocaust studies, such as the most famous case is Raoul Hilbert. He starkly defended an idea of history as totally detached in terms of its research from memory, or particularly, I will say, the memories of victims. On the other side, Dory Lau, a famous psychoanalyst and a famous, now an icon of memory studies, actually said the opposite. He said the best way to understand what happened is to ignore the historiographical record and just listen to the memories of the victims. It is not the historical experience, but the memories of the victims, which is the most perceptive element to be analyzed here. Now, I mean, this kind of opposition really fit into a mutual understanding. So you deal with victims, I deal with the perpetrators. And even like I had the opportunity to talk with Dory Lau and in a dialogue that eventually was published, and I asked him, like, who do you have in mind when you say historians? Because I mean, it seemed to me that you seem to be generalizing. And he said, well, I'm referring to a conference in which Raoul Hilbert was the speaker. And so it's interesting that this is a kind of previous paradigm, I think. Why? Because even though it is clear that, of course, history and memory are not the same, in practice they are quite conflated, first by actors in the story and then by many of us interpreters. Now, then that's why historians like Saul Friedlander or Dominic Lacapra have called our attention to the need to emphasize this dimension. Not only the fact that history and memory are different, but also that in practice many times they are, I would say, conflated, and that requires attention and study by historians. So we cannot really leave that opposition standing, because in a way it's a conceptual opposition. In my view, normatively speaking as an historian, a right one. I mean, it's totally right. It's correct, in my view. And yet, on the other hand, they are often conflated. Now, in terms of memory studies, other influential works have been by non-historians such as Michael Rothberg or Marianne Hirsch. Particularly, Michael Rothberg has called our attention to the importance of what he calls multidirectional memories, which is to say, and to put it very simply, that the Holocaust had an impact in other histories. That's the main point. But to put it perhaps more politely, I will say that there are connections between different memories. Then, More recently, also, there is another development in Holocaust historiography itself, and this is very, we live in such a small world, because when I see my colleague here, Dick Moses, that I didn't know you were here, actually, but you were part of my presentation. There is a new trend in Holocaust studies, emphasizing the actual historical connections. I mean, not only, both historical and also conceptual, the conceptual need to analyze the Holocaust vis-a-vis other genocides. And this is a need which is both synchronic in terms of what goes on, even what went on before the Holocaust, but also diachronic in the sense of a more comparative history of genocide. Similar developments and similar emphasis and curvature emphasis has been explored by historians like the Hebrew University scholar Amos Goldberg or Dan Stone here in London. Well, they are in London, I guess, here in England. I think other influential historians to consider in this equation will be, and I promise to finish with my naming of names, I think Sebastian Conrad's work on global history is important because it shows the need to go a little beyond like what he calls national containers. And I think some of this goes on in the analysis of the history and memory of things, specifically the analysis of the history and memory of cases of mass political violence, state terrorism, or genocide. In the Argentine case, the works of all these people have been very influential. That's why I'm quoting them as well. And Argentine scholars or scholars of Argentina, these are two very different categories, sometimes are the same, sometimes they are not, have explored issues of the history and memory of the dictatorship, and I here would like to mention the work of Hugo Besetti, Beatriz Sarlo and Emilio Krenzel, analyzing, let's say, among other things, the impact of the politics of the dictatorship, of the memories of the dictatorships and the relationship between that and the current politics. So in order to understand this era, which is now called by some post-dictatorship, it's important to go back to the early period of the 1980s to see how the dictatorship started to be remembered, both by state actors and other actors. Finally, I would like to mention two more things, and that's when I'm done with all these colleagues and scholars, which is the recent work. It was published, I think, 2 months ago, of two sociologists, Alejandro Baer and Nathan Schneider. I think that, you know, what they are doing is really, really challenging, in my view, super interesting, which is the connection of different memory experiences and how they affect each other, but in a way which is not rhetorical. It's an actual analysis of the practices and why and how some practices influence each other. And I will just sum up this by saying that, and I will go back later into this, that there is an important present in which not only memories of the Holocaust were important, you know, had a conceptual importance for us, that is to say, people trying to analyze this, but also that actors thought about the Holocaust when dealing with how to remember the experience of the dictatorship. So in fact, for example, during the Argentine trials, they were clearly thinking about Nuremberg. They were clearly, meaning the state planners of these trials, they were clearly thinking about the Eichmann trial, and moreover, they were clearly thinking about the work of Hannah Arendt to think the trial. So this is, you know, for some of us, this is like, you know, a historiographical paradise of sorts. But this is a challenge, actually, because, you know, this is part of the picture that we need to analyze. And what they did, that is known. This relationship is known. But what they did is something very interesting, which they explore another chapter in this history of the politics of memory of the Holocaust and the Argentine dictatorship or the dirty war. They explore current politics of memory, or let's say the last 15 years in Spain regarding the civil war. And what they saw is that the tropes and the practices and the ways to remember the past of the civil war in Spain by many actors were not taken but highly influenced by the metaphors which were used in Argentina 20 years before, or even now. So when Spaniards were conceiving of their own politics of memory vis-a-vis the civil war, they were using even actual Argentine wars, or wars referring to the Argentine experiences. Now, the victims of the civil war were desaparecidos, and all the kind of language and metaphors that came from the Argentine context. What is interesting, they show, is that the Argentine context itself was related to the Holocaust as a provider of metaphors. So, I mean, this is really a work that I really recommend because it's very interesting. Now, what I do is, this is a complement to my own work, but I do something different, which is, as I said before, emphasizing the experience of the perpetrators, because in my view, and as I have dealt with in my own book, in The Origins of the Dirty War, in the concentration camps, and Argentina had like 340 detention centers, which, you know, I can go into that, but I think they were concentration camps. But in these, CCC or clandestine detention centers or concentration camps, when the perpetrators were torturing people, they were explaining themselves. They were telling them why they were doing this, and these are kind of my sources. And this is at least how they wanted to their victims to see their actions, how they justify their actions. And the memories of fascism and the Holocaust were central in this presentation. So many perpetrators, and we have many testimonies and many sources for this, were telling them, we are doing this to you, and we are either raping you or torturing you, or we will kill you because of what Hitler or Mussolini did. This is the explanation. Of course, I mean, as an historian, I believe that is not much to do between the experience of the Holocaust and the Argentine Dirty War. If you really push me, I would say perhaps Guatemala has something more to do with that, or Rwanda, but not Argentina. It was not a genocide. But the interesting dimension is the experiential dimension. That is to say that perpetrators in a context which was diachronically totally different decided to make the connection themselves. So that's why I talk about the politics of memory as displayed by perpetrators. So these are the politics of memory of the fascists, by the fascists, and for the fascists. And this is exactly what they did. Now, of course, you might wonder, like, for the victims, this is more than surreal. I mean, more than, in a way, horrible. Obviously, they are torturing you. If you happen to be an Argentine Jewish person, a citizen of Jewish origin, is in a way quite extreme, because I mean, you not only are experiencing a horrible, you know, degradation of your selfhood, but also you are the explanation that comes to you when they are doing this to you is that this has also a relation to a trauma in Jewish history. Now, and this is not only because of a kind of rhetorical sadism by the perpetrators, not at all, of course, that's part of it, but also that they want to make a connection. That is what made these events meaningful to them, that they were participating of a war. As one perpetrator said to a victim, we are doing to you what Hitler did to your grandparents. The difference between Hitler and we is that we will win. He lost, we will win, we will win his fight. Now, of course, I mean, it was not the same fight. The Second World War and the Argentine Dirty War, nothing to do, in many ways, in different contexts. So this is the kind of explanation. So in a way, my own argument goes a little bit against this, emphasis on the conceptual connections between the things. Because what I want to analyze is why these perpetrators found a connection between the stories. So that's my own take on this. I mean, for lack of a better term, then I use this idea of transcontextual history, but I am only married to my wife, not to that idea. So I mean, that's how I came up with this notion. But what I want to explain is like this politics of memories by perpetrators in which fascism has an important role. And then I was invited here and I had to continue the story because I wanted to know what happens after 83. Because of course conspiracy is at the center of this. It's at the center of the explanation of why they are torturing and killing people. I mean, they are torturing particularly, I mean, all the citizens, but particularly the Jewish ones, they are torturing them because they, as they explain to them, they see them as part of the conspiracy against the Argentine nation, a conspiracy that according to them, also Hitler saw. That's why, you know, they are doing it, and again, it much connects to your research, emphasis here. But then what happens after 83, when they are you know, for us, they left government, the democracy came to Argentina, dictatorship was left behind, but they don't see it as such. They see themselves as having lost a war. By the way, for many of them, the war again that Hitler lost. So in a way, this continues. But then from, they are no longer a state, you know, they are no longer making those politics of memory state memories or official memories of the state as they were doing before. I mean, there is a part in my presentation when I tell you the actual history of the dirty war. I have some time. I think it's an hour, right? So there is some time. Perhaps I could briefly tell you a couple of basic, you know, elements of it, which is that this was the dirty war. In fact, was not a war, I mean a formal war, but rather the state becoming the killer. You know, that's why some people talk about the state terrorism. But basically what happened is that the state decided to illegally detain, torture, and execute many citizens. According to the, and this is, I will return to this, there is an issue about numbers. According to the first edition of the Human Rights Report, more or less 10,000 people were killed. There are other numbers. To me, that the numbers discussion is an issue in itself, but for the sake of, you know, showing how extreme this history was, in a very urban and modern context, the state decided to kill thousands of citizens. For that, they created a network of concentration camps. There was an actual process. This was a plan. You know, a systematic campaign which was organized and planned, and we know all that. Again, let's say from the history side, we know all that. The politics of memory, it's another issue. That's why it's important to return to that distinction between history and memory, because this is not an issue of debate among historians. And being, you know, being here with Professor Evans, who is an expert, I mean, on the issue of Holocaust denial, I mean, it's in a way, there is another convergence here. By the way, what is interesting is that it's a convergence which is also sought by appealing to the cases that we know from the history of Nazism and then the history of Holocaust denial. So I mean, it's not really that as an historian I'm making the connections, but the actors go look for these connections, which in a way make them important in my view. Otherwise, I mean, it's an exercise sometimes of comparative history, which could be useful, but it's not exactly as significant for the particular history of the country. After the dictatorship, well, this is the event that the immigration officer in Heathrow made reference to. Argentina, after having waged this dirty war, which in fact, you know, as I said, was not a formal war, but the state deciding to kill citizens, then the Argentine military decided to engage in a formal war, and this was the Falklands War, or as in Argentina they will present it differently, as the Malvinas War, as I will present it, the Falklands Malvinas War. Or I will say one more thing about this. Once with a colleague we wrote an op-ed in the New York Times, which by tradition, the New York Times, they will call these islands the Falklands. And I mean, they have a particular format. The same with some Japanese/Chinese islands, which are also disputed. And we proposed to the New York Times and they accepted. And this is the perfect definition in my view. The islands known in Argentina as Malvinas and in England as Falklands. Now, I will say something that in Argentina, I mean, this is going to be filmed, so I'm happy to say it, and hopefully it will be polemic. But I will say something, that from the perspective of the history of the dictatorship, I mean, no defeat in the Falklands, perhaps we would have had more years of dictatorship. So personally, I mean, as a citizen, I'm quite, you know, I'm not unhappy at all that the Argentine military lost that war. And they lost that war. In fact, what is interesting is that they lost a war which they were trained to fight, as opposed to the war which was not a real war, that nobody trained them for, and many Argentine citizens died for, which is a dirty war. So in any case, that's another issue which I will not touch here as much, but it's the politics of memory of the war in the Malvinas or Falklands. Because from that position, and here there are no political distinctions, it seems that this war had nothing to do with the dictatorship in Argentina. And these governments of the right, the left, everybody talks about this war as if it's a legitimate, even perhaps a sacred war, that had no relation whatsoever with the military men that created it, launched it, and eventually lost it. So anyway, that is an interesting thing in itself. Like one of my mentors, Tulio Alperindongi, an historian of Argentina and Latin America that I truly admire, he told me like during the war he was teaching in Berkeley and he was talking in these terms, and that created, some people were very unhappy with. Because here, there are exceptions, but many people in Argentina, either left or right, will not realize how deeply related that war is to the particular politics of memory that the dictatorship was created at the time, for the present and for the future. Of course, going back to the past. And that past, of course, involved the history of fascism and the reclamation of these islands. I mean, if you ask me as an Argentine citizen, it's not that I care much about this particular situation. You know, if you ask me as a, even more, you push me. I mean, I wrote this in an article with a colleague in the New York Times. We actually said, we said that we believe the, sovereignty in this island should be shared. But that's my opinion. In any case, for the politics of memory, what is important is that there is a relationship between the dictatorship and the war, a factual relationship. The dictatorship had to leave. So, which is interesting in itself. So basically, these are the major events of the dictatorship. In addition to that, there were major neoliberal economic reforms during the dictatorship. And many other things that I will be happy to talk about. Yesterday, I listened here, in the other room, to a wonderful presentation by my colleague on cinema during and after the dictatorship. So there are many things to touch upon regarding the dictatorship. I'm dealing with the politics of memory, and perhaps more specifically with the politics of memory as experienced and put forward by the Argentine right. Now, perhaps I should tell you what happens afterwards. I mean, for some of you that might not be as invested as I am in the history of Argentina, I will say that if, as every national history, that dictatorship had its specificities, but actually what happens afterwards became, I think, more of a trendsetter in the world, which is how Argentina decided to deal with that dictatorship. And here again, like the memories of Nuremberg and the experiences of Nuremberg and the Eichmann trial were important, both for state actors, but also for the right they saw themselves as, clearly opposing the trials, and certainly they saw that as Nuremberg. And now I would like to read an interesting quote by Monsignor Antonio Plaza, the Archbishop of the city of La Plata, which is a very important city, it's a university town. And of course, at that time, he was calling, during the coming of democracy, he was calling for a self-amnesty, which he defined as evangelical. And the idea to really leave the past behind, move on. And then he said, he argued for reconciliation, which clearly meant a free pass for perpetrators. And then he says, and I will read, throughout the war and its tradition, amnesty laws have never been a bad thing. They quiet the spirits. This should not become our own version of Nuremberg, where we look for and kill people and commit so many irregularities. And this is to finish. Even taken away poor Eichmann. So the idea was that the Eichmann trial and the Nuremberg trial, this is one of the most important bishops in the country, archbishop, in fact. Of course, during the trial, he called the trials a Nuremberg inside out. And then more explicitly, a bunch of junk. But this view was shared by the Argentine right. I mean, the only way in which they could understand the democratization process was as a kind of justice as done by a conquering army. But in fact, what made this particular case to some extent unique, was A, that the trial, first the Truth Commission, which investigated the past of the dictatorship and its crimes. And then the trials were not imposed by a conquering army. In fact, I mean, the closest to that would have been the British army or the UK army. But they were not engaged in warfare in continental Argentina. So it was only in the Malvinas Falklands area. So the point is that, in fact, when Argentines decided to put the military on trial, they did that out of their own volition. And so this was, you know, one moment in which there was, like, I think, a reconfiguration of the politics of memory. Again, going back to these memories of the Nazis, but didn't really correspond to the historical record, to the present, basically. And the other one was perhaps more perceptive, I might say, because it's clear that the influences of both the Eichmann trial and the Nuremberg trials were important in how these trials were conceived. They were not only judicial proceedings, but they were sought as education devices, as important instruments in the politics of the memory as devised by the Argentine state, which at the time was ruled by the Radical Party. The Peronist Party, by the way, during the presidential campaign, which they lost, which is not something that happens many times in Argentina, Peronism losing, actually they have proposed, I mean, a kind of a carbon copy of Monsignor's Plaza proposal. I mean, they were talking about amnesty and moving and leaving the past behind. Now, it depends on when you analyze this story that you will say, well, this is perhaps a happy story or not. As opposed to other places, in Argentina, the Truth Commission was an instrument of eventually became an investigation that was actually used by prosecutors in the trials. That was the main element. And it didn't have the other element which you might recognize from other truth commissions, which is the issue of reconciliation. In Argentina, the idea of reconciliation was out of the picture. As influential as the Argentine case was, in fact, this is the first truth commission. In cases like South Africa or other places, the issue, or Rwanda, for example, the issue of reconciliation was part of the picture. What is interesting is that notion of reconciliation, as recognized by these Argentine planners and political actors, involved a separation between history and justice. Whereas in Argentina, the connection between history as a discipline that goes into the past and justice was central. Now, as historians, or I think we will agree with that, it depends if you analyze this situation in the 90s or in the last years that you will say, that you will think that perhaps this was like politically viable or not. Because as soon as the trials started, there were three attempts. There were many attempts at coup d'etat in Argentina. And one of the elements of the attempts at coup d'etat was to stop this investigation into the past. By the 1990s, we had a new Peronist president, President Carlos Saúl Menem, and he actually gave amnesty to the few military that had been put on trial. The previous government that had organized the trials, in fact, also after the attempts at coup d'etat, they created two laws, which one said, after this particular date, no more trials on the dictatorship. I mean, no explanation for that. And the other one legalized the idea that of blind obedience. So basically, you can judge the top generals, but not everybody below, because they were blindly obedient or following orders. So those were those laws. Then in the 1990s, amnesty to the generals, so nobody was in jail. And finally, in the 2000s, there was a restart of the trials with a new politics of memory by the state, in which not only trials continued, but now the new the new Peronist government, another Peronist government, now self-conceived as a leftist government, decided that the idea or the legitimacy of their own legitimacy was related to the trials, and things changed. So now in Argentina we have a new government, a right-wing government, but now the trials are part of the Argentine fabric. So if you think this from the present, you might say, well, this looks like a good policy, but It depends on where you see this, because it didn't look like that in the 1990s or certainly in the 1980s when tanks were on the streets. So anyway, so that's the context. In terms of memory paradigms, I will say this. In the 1970s, what you have is, you know, the politics of memory as devised by perpetrators. They are part of the present, but also they were part of the state. So the idea here was that the killings in Argentina were part of a war, which they understood theologically as a just war, a war that, as I have demonstrated in my work, they related to the wars of the Second World War and the wars of fascism, and even the Holocaust. Then the situation changes in the 1980s, where the state politics of memory are those of the victims as victims. Why I say this? Because then it will change. Lately, 20 years later, the victims will become heroes. But I will get into that in a second. Now, so that's from the position of the state. In the 1990s, the idea of reconciliation comes back, and this is a state policy now. So the idea is not to look into the past, to forget, to be happy. And then in the 2000s, the new Kirchner governments, they kind of leave behind the idea, which was really important in the trials, of the victims as victims, meaning that it doesn't matter, or it didn't matter in the trials, which was the ideology of the victims. What was important was that they were killed, illegally. By the way, there is no death penalty in Argentina. They were treated illegally and they were killed. That it was not an issue of who they were, but rather the crime committed against them. So victims as victims. Whereas in the 2000s, with the Kirchner government, there is new idea that actually there was a war, there were bad guys, the military, there were good guys, the victims, which were heroes, they were political fighters, and they were kind of proto-Kirchneristas, meaning that they were fighting for the same project that the Kirchner government was putting forward. And lately, the current right-wing government, which in a way provides a kind of closure to my analysis of the politics of perpetrators. Okay, that's the state. Let me deal with the right. In the 1970s, the right is in government, represented by the military dictatorship, and I talk about the particular memory paradigm that they present. In the 1990s, they continue that paradigm now with the idea or the recombination of the trials vis-a-vis Nuremberg and the Eichmann trial. In the 1990s, they are very happy with the reconciliation topic coming back. In a way, by the way, I would say by the 1990s, the issue of conspiracy is no longer that important. It appears, conspiracy generally appears when they are losing, whatever they believe they should be winning. So by the 1990s, everybody's fine, according to these memories of the right. What is interesting is, and this is the issue that I mentioned before, which is, which is central of denial, because basically what happens is that either they are happy or not, meaning that they engage in conspiracy or not, in conspiracy theories or not, always their approach to the history of what happened is, it didn't happen. This is the narrative that you get from former military men and other sectors in the Argentine right. Basically, there was a war, in a war people died, but there was no systematic campaign of elimination, and thereby the state cannot be blamed as a terrorist actor, because this was done by kind of crazy guys, some crazies, but not, it was not a planned policy by the state. Then in the 2000s, conspiracy comes back again, because particularly corresponds to the president confirming some of these fears, telling them, you're right, there was a war and we won. And this is, what they say, we lost. And as General Videla said in a couple of interviews that he did before dying, which is an incredible source, he said, Gramsci won, the enemy adopted a Gramscian strategy, they won the battle of memory, and we lost, and I'm in jail. And he says very interesting things here. There is no time, but in the Q&A I could use some of these examples. But basically this idea that there was a war which was a just war and they lost. They won the war, they lost the battle of memory. But what is interesting is that in this book, General Videla already announces a kind of break, which I would like to finish with that, in the Argentine politics of memory as presented by the right. meaning those who identify, in fact, with the side of perpetrators under the dictatorship. Because why, if you are a right-wing actor, you need to identify with that? And this is exactly the question that some people on the right start asking themselves, because it's not politically viable, politically profitable. Perhaps they think this. Now, Videla already said in this book, breaking with many members of the right, he said, yeah, there was a planned campaign of extermination. Perhaps it was not the best idea, but it was. Then he engaged with the numbers. 10,000 people were killed. But he says this, which is interesting. It's symptomatic of even the most important dictator already is breaking with this idea of denial to some extent, because he is recognizing that there was a systematic campaign planned by the state. So he recognized this in many parts of these interviews, which were eventually published in this book. And this is interesting again for the topic that I was advancing before, which is these connections as experienced by the victims with the Holocaust, because he says, I read that phrase, the final solution, we never use it. Final disposition, that's what we use. Both concepts are very military, and what they mean is take out of service a thing that is no longer of use. So he's referring to the disappearances of people, the killing of people. So it's interesting. So he's making a distinction between the memory of the Holocaust, and then he's somehow, because I mean, why he's referring to the final solution. So he's participating of this, relationship between the Argentine things and the memories of the Holocaust as experienced by perpetrators. Now, finally then, what is going on with the Argentine right, and why there is such a split that even General Videla somehow thought that it was a time for recognition, that very late time in his case, for recognizing that what happened. I would say this issue came to, is even more, symptomatic and to some extent scandalous in the current Argentine government. Because there are two tensions, or at least two positions in the current Argentine administration, between people in the government that actually continue the denial and say, people were killed, but there was no systematic campaign, those are lies. This is there is a famous scandal as of January of this year by the director of customs in Argentina, national director of customs, who said that, and many other things, that there was no plan, and he says there was not a genocidal plan. I do not share that view of history, but somehow he implies that he has a historical position. But what actually happens is that he clearly relates to this long history of the politics of memory as presented by Argentine perpetrators. Now, believe it or not, that person, is still in his position and was not demoted or asked to leave the government. On the other hand, you have other members of the government that they say, what happened, but we need to move on. And this is the current tension, a kind of populism light that we have in Argentina, which an idea of post-politics, according to which there is a government of CEOs that know how to plan things. They are led by a kind of fatherly figure in many ways, but history has no place in this position. So, and this is, and this comes to the fore in the last scandal of this. I have many scandals and affairs that I wanted to talk about regarding the issue of politics of memory in Argentina. Almost every single day we have one. When Macri, which is the current right-wing president, came to power, people that oppose him decided to say, this is the main, political point, I guess, is a slogan, which is Macri, basura, vos sos la dictadura, which means Macri, piece of garbage, you are the dictatorship, which in fact, historically, that's not right. We are talking about an elected government, perhaps with authoritarian positions, but it's an elected government. So why conflate that and the actual experience of dictatorship? So that's one. And then more complicated, because it appears that the government that Macri defeated, will stand with a kind of proper or historical view of the dictatorship, when in fact, as I said, it really displays the place of the victims, creating a kind of mythical history of heroes and bad guys. And not only that, because that's an argument that you could argue, but I mean, and I refer to this, General Milani, who was the Joint Chief of Staff, something like that. I don't know which is the position in the UK military forces, but basically the top guy in the armed forces. He was known and denounced by many victims as a perpetrator in the dirty war. Even he was accused of being responsible of torture and even killing one soldier. And he was named by the previous Kirchner government to be the most important military man in the country. And they said, well, he's innocent, there is no justice proceedings, which was not true, and so on and so forth. So now we have this guy detained. This guy is in prison behind bars during this investigation. We are seeing this happened 2 or 3 days ago, but I think here we have in display the same politics of the right, because there are some people that say he's in the right place, he should be in prison, let's forget about this and move on. So recognizing history, but making it in a way less part of our present. And some other people that say that he's, and I mean people in the government, actually, that say that his position is not in jail, or his situation is not in jail. So in this, I think that in this post-political moment that we are experiencing, and by this I mean populism, which is to say the idea that what they do is not really typical, it's not politics. Somehow they are beyond that, and this is how they present it. In these ideas, which are epitomized in Argentina with this light version of populism right now, there is a lot of this politics of memory, now intention, as I hope I demonstrated, but history remains out of the picture. Thank you.
Thank you, Federico, for that extremely rich discussion of the many ways in which the so-called dirty war has been thought about, mobilized over the past 34 years. And I think for establishing so clearly the multiphasal dimension of those narratives as well as their synchronic interplay. So I'd just like to offer 2 or 3 thoughts and questions, and then we'll open up to questions. I think that this work is particularly important today for 2 reasons. First, simply because so much of the current scholarship on post-authoritarian Argentina, not just in history, focuses either broadly on the left or exclusively on Peronism, which, as Federico outlined, is hard to situate on a spectrum from left to right. So barring the work of the sociologist Lee Payne, for example, who interviewed perpetrators of humanitarian violence, there's little landmark work, and particularly historiography, that seeks fully to interrogate the attitudes and opinions that have circulated on the far right since 1983. So acknowledging the kinds of memories and continuities of thought that you trace, and even more so, I think, when we read them alongside your earlier work in the ideological origins of the dirty war, really contributes to overcoming the very ruptured and apparently clean-cut periodizations that sometimes characterize the historiography on Argentina. Despite, as you say, the nomenclature, which with the post-authoritarian label, which kind of does 2 things at once, both separating and stubbornly kind of reinstating that continuity. But I hope you won't mind my saying that I think this work also makes a broader and perhaps unintentionally political contribution today, which is to say that we're living through a moment outside Latin America that's teaching us the hard way about the importance of attempting to understand genealogies of ideas and narratives that we may not agree with, but that clearly hold sway over large swathes of citizens. And I think it's fair to say, in both the European and US cases, some of our immediate shock surrounding the votes resulted from a failure to attend in any concentrated way to the social life and the contemporary social history of those discourses. In part because they seem to us unsavoury, and we prefer not to spend our hours digging into them in the archives or hearing directly from their followers. But I think your talk has done just that, albeit in a different context. It's both illuminated the intricacies of the Argentine case and provided a model for the kind of work that may be increasingly necessary on a global level and with a focus on other national and regional contexts. So with that in mind, my first question relates to this social dimension of the history of ideas, and specifically the recent Argentine history of conspiracy as a mechanism for representing the past. So one of our former speakers here, the historian Darren McMahon, has written that the job of the historian is to attend to ideas wherever they were lived. And writing about Europe, he observes that an almanac or a newspaper is as good a source for tracing the fortunes of many ideas as, say, a treatise in political theory. But in Argentina, as elsewhere, that extended textual range would still only provide insight into the thoughts and emotions of a delimited and elite demographic, of individuals who had access to participating in writing in the public sphere. And the kinds of ideas you trace clearly live in, but also beyond those textual contexts. So I think we need to think about the right-wing press and historiography as points of dissemination, but also to consider the other spaces that make up, if you like, the everyday life of right and far-right conspiracy theories. So I'd like to ask you about the history of the spaces in which the ideas that you trace have circulated and developed. So whether that's the football stadium, perhaps the classroom, journals, and social spaces. And what shifts and stagnations are evident in the types of forums in which these ideas have been hosted and disseminated over the past 30 years or so. And with that in mind also, to what extent have they appealed to the same audiences or ended up garnering new ones? And I mention stagnations because I do think it's worth underlining that virulently xenophobic and anti-Semitic publications, such as Cabildo, for example, the mouthpiece of the Catholic ultra-right, very much continued into the post-authoritarian period. And in the case of Cabildo, it not only lasted, but now has an online identity and presence under the slogan, "Someone has to tell the truth." So what does the history of the spaces of circulation of these ideas and memories look like? And how might that contribute to providing also this less ruptured picture of contemporary history? And I'd also like to ask you about the relationship between ideas, events, and networks. So the picture that you sketched largely focused on discourses and ideas, but of course, these are rarely isolated from the realm of events and practices. And you mentioned the coups in the 1980s, for example. And then in the 1990s, of course, we had the bombing of the Israeli embassy in 1992 and the bombing of the Amiad Jewish Community Center in 1994. So these later acts of violence were not only clearly anti-Semitic in character, but also opened the floodgates to further anti-Jewish public discourse of the type that's long abounded, you know, even before the presentation that you gave, early into the 19th century even. So the Amiad bombing, many of you will know, remains unsolved, though Iran and its Hezbollah connections have long been considered the prime suspects. But amid the initial confusion and unknowns, far-right conspiracy theories circulated in which the Jewish community was said to have carried out the attack on itself. Others blamed the Jews for bringing danger to Argentina. And even the most well-intentioned voices revealed the extent to which the Jews, following the dirty war trajectory, were not perceived as full members of the revised democratic community. So an example of this is when the Argentine ambassador to the US noted soon after the attack that Argentina generously would not ask the Jews to leave in the wake of the attack, as though they were some unwelcome dinner guests. Not citizens.
That's what's very generous.
Not citizens. Many of his ancestors had already been in Argentina for quite a few generations. So while there's a long history of voracious and violent, a domestic history of anti-Jewish sentiment and behaviours in Argentina, I also want to ask specifically how the brand of nationalist and often anti-Semitic thought that manifests on the far right in the 90s, around the time of the Amiad attack, fits into broader international networks of thought. So for example, were the Pan-Arabist connections of the earlier Taquarista movement still intact? Did they have direct international links with far-right thinkers elsewhere, beyond the age-old anti-Semitic conspiracy theories and domestic dirty war tropes? What synchronic contemporary international political ideas were the far-right most directly engaging with? And then, just to end, a final question on Macri in the present and the new paradigm that you outlined. So you mentioned a new memory paradigm in which the Argentine right, or some at least on it, are attempting to distance themselves from early, more conspiracy-minded versions. And the Macrista government, as you mentioned in the idea of populism light, fuses technocratic rule with an appeal to some of the populist aesthetics with which Argentines are so familiar. This right appears to prefer to forget the past rather than actively use it. And that oblivion is their politics of history, in a sense, and appears to root from a technocratic approach to societal problem solving, in which, simply put, the past doesn't seem to them, at least in this instance, a useful, pragmatic device for producing their desired future. So I'd just like to ask you about one specific point, which we discussed a little earlier, which is Macri's recent immigration reform. So just to summarise, the law that Macri has implemented just a few weeks ago, he says is to target drug trafficking, which is currently a major problem in Argentina. And the law specifically prohibits the entry of foreign nationals with past involvement in drug trafficking and other associated organised crime. And in explaining the reform, the security minister controversially made reference to the role of Bolivians, Paraguayans and Peruvians in the drug trafficking chain, which unsurprisingly ignited indignation in the region and sparked accusations of Trumpist policymaking. Now, clearly any immigration policy that targets Bolivians and Paraguayans can't help but hint at the undoubtedly racist nacionalista superiority complex and associated extreme right positions. But to place the law squarely in that narrative, as some have already done, is also then to cast Macri in the figure of the old right. So in light of the latter part of your talk, I wondered if you had any thoughts on the meaning of this immigration reform. Was it clumsy wording that then became available for cannibalising alongside the impetus of Trump into a far-right narrative that has included the touting of the idea of a wall with Bolivia? Or are we seeing some kind of subtle resurgence? So I'll leave it there. I'm sure there are plenty more questions to come.
Should I answer now?
As you prefer. Do you want to feel your own questions?
However, is the...
Either way, I can feel the questions for you.
No, it's fine. No,
okay.
So I collect more questions and then...
As you prefer, your choice. If you have...
Well, I can answer some. I will try to be brief so we can talk more. I will start with the last one. Well, I think that there is it's not that let's say that Trump and Trumpismo is the platonic form of populism, but rather that it legitimizes trends which certainly in a country like Argentina have been going on for a long time, and that's part of my life work. Is related to that. I really dedicated a lot of my of my thinking times to that issue. These traditions of xenophobia. But there is now a global legitimacy to this, which I think we see also here in the UK. The question is not rather, in my view, whether Macri is imitating Trump, but it is clear that politically he's doing this after Trump, and thereby there is a relationship. That's how he perceives it, and as they have said, we are not, even by denying certain elements, one minister in his government said, we are not going to build a wall with Bolivia. Where that came from? As an Argentine historian, I don't recall such an idea, period, like in the history of Argentina. So this is coming from the American context. By the way, the trajectories are not that dissimilar. Macri is the son of one of the wealthiest families in Argentina. He came to politics as a kind of celebrity himself. Rather than Trump, he did this in the Berlusconi way. He was the president of Boca Juniors, not the only one, by the way, one of the most important teams in the country. Because I'm from River Plate. But he came, perhaps one of the most famous teams, as I said. He was famous because of that. He was famous because of, his particular, life in the celebrity magazines and the world of his partners and fashion modeling. And eventually he wanted to be, he switched from soccer to politics and he was successful. So, and his claim, as it was the claim by Trump, is that he's a millionaire who knows how to run the country like a business, and so on and so forth. So, I mean, there are connections there, by the way. The families are quite, you know, quite connected. Trump knows Macri for many decades. Actually, it was the current Argentine president that negotiated with Trump in the 1990s the selling of Macri properties in Manhattan. So they know each other very well. So there are connections there. So to me, the connection is clear between this. And this is, again, trendy, I mean, to say the least. It seems that this is a successful way of doing politics. And certainly in the Argentine right, that is not a problem. So I see a connection there. Now, and this connects to your other point, which is very important, to the history of antisemitism. I mean, in my book on the Dirty War, I start the book with a particular statistics, which is why, if Jews were and are less than 1% of the country's population, they were between 10 to 15% of the victims of the dictatorship. So that's the question that I ask in the book. And my answer, well, there are many reasons. One of them was the fascist ideology that legitimized and motivated the perpetrators. In the present, as in Europe or as in the US, I don't think the main problem is antisemitism. I mean, I don't want to sound too comfortable, but I mean, as Argentine Jews, I think we are fine. I mean, I think now there are the people that are mostly discriminated in Argentina are immigrants, particularly from the countries you mentioned. So I think that these are the new Jews, between quotation marks, and so to speak. And the same you see in the US with people from Mexico and Muslim immigrants, and the same you see in Europe, especially with Muslim immigrants. So there are connections between all these histories of persecution. But that doesn't mean that now this is the main topic. This, in a way, it correlates to other topics, and it kind of makes sense for the Argentine right. Now, this is more, I think you know more about some of the topics you ask than I know. I mean, regarding the bombings of the, you know, of Daya Amia. Incidentally, I mean, I'm a source, really. I was working there in a project as a young student, in a project on the investigation of Nazi activities in Argentina and our meetings, and my job, which was part-time, was on Wednesdays, not on Mondays. Otherwise, if the bomb was on Wednesday, I would not be here telling the story. So I really have, this is not a topic that I will do research on. I have many, this is many, much more related to memory in my case. But still, I mean, I think you are right on point that these histories are conspiracies. You might add the stories about, you know, Nazi submarines going to Patagonia and the anti-Semitic notion of a Jewish plan to conquer Patagonia and so on and so forth. So there are, you know, that's a very rich topic to do research. Now, the social dimension. The social dimension, I think it is very important. Again, you know more about this than I know. I had, like, I mean, I only researched, I mean, after, like, for a conference in Texas once, I was asked to talk about, many years ago, about what happened between the Argentine right and September 11. So I went to Cabildo and I read it. I'm trying to analyze that kind of what then was a turning point in current history. In order to see the Argentine right's response. I mean, and the conspiracy, I mean, in Cabildo, you have, like, the traditional right approach. Like, I haven't read it lately, but generally you have that, like, the conspiracy. I mean, the idea of normalizing the history and moving forward, that's not part of Cabildo's position. It never happened. So that's my short answer to these very important points. But, yeah.
About, I was interested in the connection that you highlighted within the perpetrators' minds between the memories of the Holocaust and, you know, what they were saying that they were doing to the victims. The reason I'm interested in it is to ask you, really, what's the connection between that kind of talk and the fact that a good chunk of the victims were trade unionists? Right, and, you know, and so is there, you know, is it the kind of the Jewish identity that was being attacked through these memories and through this talk, or how was their identity as Miguelistas mobilized through the talk of the perpetrators? And I suppose another question might be, were the two connected in any way?
Yes, I mean, look, I mean, when you analyze a perpetrator's ideology, it's not really, I mean, the problem is that there is not sometimes much connection between what they say and the truth. I mean, even in what is the crazy part, and we know this from studies of Nazism and the Holocaust, as well as other examples of fascism, is that they with these lies, they create new realities, and whatever they say becomes somehow true. So if they say that prisoners should be dirty, eventually they make a war in which they are dirty. If they say Jewish prisoners spread disease, that is not a fact, but they create conditions in which they will do so. And so basically it is important to, you know, there is a trick there, because sometimes there is no connection, but it doesn't matter who they were. Sometimes it matters, but in a way, the way I approach this is that I'm interested in who they, what they are saying. So in a way, these perpetrators would, some people would say, you know, I'm not Jewish. And the perpetrator would say, it doesn't matter what you say, you are Jewish. So, I mean, this is, you know, so you cannot argue with that, because you cannot argue with fascism. I mean, so that's part of the experience. Now, it is true that sometimes the perpetrators will distinguish, and this varies with perpetrators, will distinguish between different targets of enemies. So famously, a famous one is one perpetrator telling a Jewish victim, you know, with the other people that are on the left, that's my job, to torture them. With you, it's fun. So you have, I mean, again, it cannot be fun, but it's just an ideological justification to the particular, let's say, excess in the torture. And this, quote-unquote, excess was recognized by many victims, and they say it seemed that to the extent that it was possible, they went even farther with the Jewish victims. Now, this relates to the question of how these numbers, because people were not targeted for being Jewish. They were targeted for, in the perception of the dictatorship, being leftist enemies of the state. So it doesn't matter what they were, whether they were actually engaged in, you know, illegal acts of violence against the state or not. I mean, that's another discussion. The question is why they were targeted by the dictatorship. I mean, because if they were targeted by a court of law, then you can engage with that kind of a situation. So the point is that it seems from the testimonies, and even this was stated in the human rights reports in the Nunca Más, this particular distinction of the Jewish dimension, that there is a section in the Nunca Más, in the Truth Commission report about anti-Semitism. Because once they were inside the concentration camp network, I wouldn't even say, perhaps, I mean, some prisoners said, you know, there was a harshness that was, I wouldn't even go there, because it doesn't, you know, that's politics of memory. But the point is that it seemed that they were following another path, a kind of different understanding. So they became Jews and part of a particular conspiracy inside the concentration camps, and they were treated as Jews, no longer as something else. Some of them may have been this or that. Now, what is interesting is that they were, obsessed with these ideas of conspiracy, even to the extent that they were wiretapping conversations of Argentine citizens in Yiddish. You know, for example, the language that my grandparents spoke with my dad. I mean, they were speaking Yiddish by the phone, but since they didn't understand, they were obsessed by that, and they were asking outsourcing the, you know, the listening word to victims, and they say, tell me what they are saying. So they were wiretapping conversations in Yiddish because they were convinced this was part of the plan. And the famous lie about a Jewish, it's a kind of anti-Semitic lie about a Jewish plan to conquer Patagonia, was repeated in the interrogations, the so-called Plan Andinia. I mean, they were asking Jews to tell them that this was a fact. And this is interesting about truth and lies, right? That they were creating conditions in which they wanted their lies to become truth, even to the extent that they were asking victims to say something in order not to be tortured. So there is a, you know, this is a, anyway, I will stop there, because, go ahead.
So three short questions. One is...
I will give you three short answers. Yes.
One is, you often refer to the perpetrators as them. But when I was in ESMA, one of the things I learned with us was that there was a lot of disagreement between the Navy and the Army, and that's one of the reasons that the numbers of victims increased, because of the negotiations. And so how much homogeneity you see in the ideology? Then the other one is about the sources of, kind of popular sources of the Holocaust
in the minds of the perpetrators. How did they learn about Nazism? Was it through films? Were they actually reading books, or was it just what they had heard, or you know, how direct are these sources? And the last one is that talking to an Argentine historian, Cristina Vega, she does films mostly, she said that a lot of the archives were burned. How do you speak archives of torture interrogations?
Well, I mean, that's the easier one. I mean, these are important questions. We have a lot of archival materials because, happily, the Truth Commission and the trials happened right after the dictatorship, and they compile an incredible amount of state materials, including a lot of testimonies taken at the time, because, I mean, which is interesting. And we have access to those materials of the trials. Actually, the archives of the prosecution, most of the archives were transferred, and this is, in a way, I'm not proud of this. They were transferred to Scandinavia, to one country, I think it's Norway, because they microfilmed them in order to secure them, because who knows what will happen in the future. That's what they thought. And they were kind of right. There were a couple of attempts at coup d'etat in Argentina to suppress this stuff. But, I mean, there are many archives, and actually, incredibly, this is an Argentine thing. The main prosecutor, Luis Moreno Campos, who then became the international prosecutor in the International Criminal Court, he donated he photocopied, although this was not exactly, you know, standard procedure, he photocopied all his archives of the prosecution, because he was concerned about the fact that these archives might be lost. And then he donated this to a human rights archive, which means that although it's not exactly legal to, you know, to go and ask the state for all these documents, you go to this other archive and you have them.
But they were so, in the tribe. They were like
some of them, yes. Like, what you don't have, and again, like another interesting connection, is that you don't have like a particular order if you are looking for that, but that doesn't mean much. And then, you know, in some of these interviews, a former interior minister, Albano Arguindegui, General Arguindegui, says, you know, I had a list. I have it in my safe, but then we burn it. I mean, in a way, I don't think it is that important if that appears or not. I mean, the facts are quite established. I mean, the question of what they were reading, this is, you know, I think this is a kind of, there are important connections. And what they were reading is Argentine fascist texts in the Argentine fascist tradition. And also because the Argentine fascist tradition, as all others, was quite transnational, and they were connecting to that since the 1920s and moving forward. One of the awkward practices is that they will play in torture chambers across, and this is your other question, across the in different testimonies we see in different provinces, they will play recordings of speeches by Hitler or Mussolini, which probably the perpetrators didn't even understand, but apparently it gave them a sense of elation or historic ideological justification just to listen to the Führer and, you know, torturing people. I mean, and most of these people didn't even know German. But so this is a kind of memories. I mean, this is what I call the memories of perpetrators. They were quite connected, and some of them actually interacted with the man himself, with Eichmann, and there is a long history of Nazi connections in Argentina, by the way. So, I mean, Eichmann is a very interesting thing. It's one of the moments in which these histories really become transnational or global, or at least the moment in which it's obvious that this is the case. Because the Eichmann trial was extremely important for the Argentine right as a part of their ideas of conspiracy. And they saw this as an illegal action by a foreign state against an Argentine citizen. This is their claim. And they related that to their promises to kill the Jews of Argentina if they kill Eichmann. So you see this in graph. I mean, sources are fantastic for this. There are police reports, graffitis, like pamphlets. I have done research in the security archives, the security police. Those archives have been declassified. And you see all these secret services analyzing the neo-fascists and the fascists and pictures of the walls of Argentina and leaflets and a lot of stuff, what they are saying about the Eichmann trial. Now, to confirm those transnational connections, as told by Hannah Arendt, and you might recall, the guy himself, they asked him, for Arendt, this is a famous moment because it shows the banality of the man, even in his last speech. They said, what do you want to say before dying? And he says, long live Austria, long live Germany, long live Argentina. And the Argentine fascists were, he's talking to us. Of course he was talking to them. Because Eichmann himself was asked, and this is in my book, was asking the trials in Jerusalem whether he had any contacts with General Perón, and he said, well, I was more into a nationalist view. So he's, I mean, he had lived in Argentina and he understood what Argentine nationalism was, and this is a connection. And then that's why the bishop that I mentioned before, he makes the connection somehow. Poor Eichmann is related to the Argentine trials, this is an Argentine history. And you know, in Argentina, Argentines, we are famous for being very self-centered, and it's clear that as a kind of a stereotype of the Argentine fascists will be quite self-centered and interpret these stories, including the Eichmann trial, through Argentine eyes.
We have time for one more question.
So if I might, like, we have time. the issue of the Jewish. You asked me a question about the Jewish victims, no?
About the
first question.
Was the ideology?
Oh yes, the connection between the. Okay. Okay. So yeah, I will be brief. I mean, there is a famous statement of one of the generals in the testimony that in many things we disagree, for example, neoliberalism versus a more autarkic politics, but in the decision about the repression, we all agree. And there is, I mean, it's amazing how across forces there is such an understanding. Of course, in different camps and in different forces, you have a particular ways of dealing with things, but the decision was made to go against, you know, an increasing amount of citizens. So there are many... I mean, the ideological motivations which decided the act and the organization are there as well.
Okay, well, let's thank Federico for that wonderful talk and then move outside.
Thank you.